guys, once again, this is Dr. Bill Bailey, and this is VirtZine. VirtZine is the online magazine of virtualization and cloud computing, and I'm glad you could join us for this particular edition of VirtZine. We are proud members of the Tech Podcast Network, techpodcast.com. If it's tech, it's right here on the VirtZine netcast. We're also proud members of the International Association of Internet Broadcasters. So we're glad you joined us for this particular broadcast. And this particular edition of VirtZine is going to be about virtualization platforms. Now, you might say, well, of course, Dr. Bill, that would be VMware. That would be Zen Server. Well, yes, those are virtualization platforms, but these are a little bit more unusual, maybe less known virtualization platforms. So I'd encourage you to stay tuned for what we're going to be talking about. The first one I want to talk about is Proxmox VE. And I actually have a walkthrough of that, kind of a demo of it, that we'll show you right now.
All right, we are looking at Proxmox Virtual Environment. This was recommended by one of our listeners, viewers, and I am actually very impressed with this. As you can see, I have an installation going here of Microsoft Windows 7, and I like this because I can move the console right over here and I can watch the CPU and memory usage right as the installation is going on. This is installed on one of my spare machines. It's running a solid-state drive, and so the performance is of course really good because of that. In a real-world environment, Proxmox would be used on different systems with shared storage to give you a full virtualization environment and the ability to migrate between hosts for maximum uptime. But here, in this particular environment, for testing, I'm actually very impressed with how this works. You can come over here and see your hardware, your various options, task history that you basically are logging what's going on. Then you can do backup, actually do backup and do snapshots from here. Has a firewall, various permissions. But going back to the summary view, if I click on our test box here, this local machine we're calling Proxmox, and then the test is the VM that I have started. And then I can go right over here to console, and I can choose no VNC, VNC, or Spice. Basically, if we go with the regular VNC connection, and you can see that it really is nice. I mean, I hate to sound like I'm so amazed, but I really am, because this is working extremely well. And to be an open source virtual environment, which, by the way, this is using KVM in this particular test case. And it's very, very fast, very effective, and I've been very impressed with it. I think it's going to be a real handy tool to have in our arsenal, and I'm still exploring it, as a matter of fact. I can go in here, server view, folder view, storage view. That should be interesting to go in here and look at our storage. Let's see, pool view, which, of course, probably isn't very useful in our current setup because I've only got it on this one machine, but very nice. I mean, you know, this is kind of cool. It's the kind of thing, by the way, you'd go up here and click create VM and step through a wizard to do the creation of the VM. But this is the no VNC console. As you can see, my installation is proceeding along here. The media that I'm using, I kind of, you might say, cheated a bit here. I'm using the CD built into this host, and that was one of the options, use CD on host. I can use that and doing it that way. Now we're booting. Notice it auto-adjusted for the screen. That's kind of nice. And I see very little overhead here. I mean, it really is installing about as fast as it would directly to the machine, which, you know, that's kind of the beauty of of KVM anyway. Let me scroll it off the edge here and let's look at the settings. It's using 80% roughly of the one CPU that I allocated to it. Managed by high availability, that's kind of interesting. CPU usage, very, very nice. I'm just real impressed with it. I think if you're looking for a virtual environment at a very low cost, if you're using it professionally, you want support, there is support for it. As a matter of fact, that was one of the things as it booted that it came up with, is if you want support, you do have to pay for that. There you can migrate from one host to another. Just really impressive. And you notice here too that you're getting into it through a web connection. In this case, the address and then :8006 is the port, and then it appended all this to it. All of my other console things that I opened are there. So there we go. I'm going to go ahead and log in. Type one of my super secret passwords. Actually, let me try that again. There we go. And hint, we'll just say hint. I have found in the past that if you don't put anything there, it'll fuss at you. So I'm going to go ahead and use that. That looks good. Yeah, we're on the home network. Yeah, I'm very pleased with this. I really am. I think this could be a very valuable tool. No, we're not going to do a home group. We just want to go ahead and get it up. There we go. Now, what I'm really curious about, and one reason I'm kind of hanging in here, is I want to see if I can adjust the video once I get in here to a higher resolution than the standard resolution. That could be very interesting because I'm using it here on a very large monitor, 27-inch monitor. So let's go to screen resolution, see what our options are. Look at that. I've got all the options that I could possibly need based on the monitor, the real monitor. So it's actually sensing the monitor. Keep the changes, and there we go. That's pretty nice, I gotta admit. So, I think this is a great environment to use. Particularly, can you imagine this in a small business where you're really limited in terms of your cost? This is an article I was looking at earlier to get the information about logging into the GUI through the web. But let's go to Proxmox.com and look at subscription plans. This is something that I looked at earlier. Now, as you can see, Proxmox, I believe, is out of Germany, but the pricing they have here is based on the euro. So the community gives you access to the enterprise repository, stable software updates, support via community forum, and it's 416 euros per CPU per month. Now, that would be interesting in the case of this particular system because I believe there's a lot of CPUs on this system. Let's see, 416. Let's do a quick conversion on that. 416 euros equivalent in dollars. Dollar. There we go. EU to dollar conversion. 416. Oh, that's $531 US dollars. Interesting. So basically what we're saying is if this were a quad core machine, which I think it may be a little bit more than that, but if it were a quad core machine, we're looking at about $20 per month. So again, if you're a business and you want support, then you're looking at about $20 a month to be able to have at least community support, updates, and access to the enterprise repository. You can go ahead and continue up in terms of standard and premium and have so many support tickets per year, remote login via SSH, etc. But you know, right out of the box, so to speak, using it in this fashion, I can see that this would be useful, so to speak, without even having any support. Not that I would encourage that for a business, but for a lab situation, this would really be awesome. So, hope you found this interesting. This is the Proxmox Virtual Environment. This was version 3.3-1 that we're looking at here today.
Okay, hope you enjoyed that demo and saw what we're talking about here. Unique platforms for virtualization that maybe you haven't considered before. The next one I want to talk about is an unusual one, and it is CoreOS. CoreOS. It is a Linux distro that's designed for virtualization. It's a slimmed-down Linux distribution designed for easy creation of lots of OS instances. In other words, the hypervisor there for OS instances to be built upon. It uses Docker to deploy applications in virtual containers, and it features a management communications bus and group instance management. Rackspace, Amazon Web Services, Google Compute Engine, and Brightbox are early cloud compute providers compatible with CoreOS and with specific deployment capacity for CoreOS. So pretty interesting stuff going on here with CoreOS. Now, as I mentioned, it is small. It is very thin. In fact, it will save critical amounts of memory for some users. And even though it is Spartan, it has some useful features built into it. So I encourage you to check out CoreOS, which has many similarities to Ubuntu, but is a really neat virtualization platform. Now, another one that you need to consider is oVirt. I like the name, oVirt. It's O-V-I-R-T, oVirt for a virtual data center based on open source technologies. It is another Linux distro that you install on your bare metal hardware, and it provides a platform for virtualizing your various systems. It manages virtual machine storage and virtualized networks, and it has a web-based interface to get into it. The features that it has are its high availability, live migration, load balancing, web-based management interface, as I mentioned, self-hosted engine, iSCSI, fiber channel, NFS, and local storage options, enhanced security with SE Linux and mandatory access control for VMs and the hypervisor, scalability with up to 64 vCPU and 2 terabyte VRAM per guest. Wow. Memory overcommit support with kernel same page merging, and developer SDK for oVirt engine written in Python. Pretty powerful stuff available to you through this Linux distro, but called oVirt. All right. So, Proxmox, and then CoreOS, and then oVirt. Those are three options for you to look into for your virtualization open source free virtualization choices. So check them out. And remember, until next time, to keep your head in the cloud.